welcome everyone to the Hollywood Dreams podcast. This is your host Santi Trix, along with my other host David Melikand. Hey Dave, how are you?
Good, Santi. How are you?
I'm doing great, man. It's a nice Saturday. It's a bit rainy, but I love rainy days, so I'm fine with it. And
I'm pretty excited, man. I get to go see Wasp for the first time tonight.
Oh, nice!
So I'm pretty pumped about that.
First time ever.
First time ever. Wasp is one of those bands I just haven't had a chance to see. I'm seeing them in the same place that I saw White Snake for the first time a few years back. And White Snake was another one of those bands that were kind of.
Well, would you look at that? That's awesome, man.
It's awesome. I can't wait.
Have a great time. Yeah.
Right now I'm more excited for this
episode. Well, yeah, I mean, we got one hell of a guest tonight, tonight or today or whatever you're watching this. it's 5 o'clock somewhere. So we got Danny Vaughn from a lot of bands, TYKETTO, Waysted. He's done a lot of stuff over the years, so we are really excited to talk about that. So, hey, Danny, welcome to the show.
Thank you, guys. How's everybody doing?
Good, man. I'm doing better now.
Yeah,
excellent.
Totally.
All right. Well, I'm looking forward to hearing what you got. What are we gonna talk about?
So you're in Spain now, right? You moved to Spain?
Yeah. All the way down in the south of Spain.
Nice.
How cool is it there?
Oh, we love it. Although I am a little jealous. We're well into our winter and still have had no rain, and we could really use some. So
nice.
Yeah, here in Ohio, Cleveland, Ohio, by the way, Danny. We just started getting our little bit of snow, our first bit of snow here. So
wow. Yeah, no, but, I'm not ready for that yet.
Yeah, me neither. But you can't stop it. It's here, so
yeah. So how long have you been living in Spain?
About 13 years.
Wow. Okay, so you're local now.
Yeah, well, I wish I could be a little more local. My Spanish is not good.
Was it hard adapting to, like, a new language?
I'm just not very good with languages. Plus, I have a crutch in that my beautiful wife speaks Spanish very well, so she got a conversation locally. But I keep trying because, you know, I grew up in New York City, and of course there were a lot of Spanish speaking people. So I certainly learned all the bad words right away. That was easy, and then important people in my neighborhood and knowing that they'd been there for like 10 years and they didn't speak English. And I thought, you know, what's wrong with them? Why aren't they speaking English by now? And now I understand. It's like, it's not as easy as it sounds.
No, definitely. Yeah. Learning a different language. Yeah, definitely. Well, I'm from Argentina. And so I've been, I've started learning English like at 5 years old, something like that. So, and I work in an American company, so I speak English all day. But yeah, sometimes it's hard to because you can't think in Spanish and then translate as you talk because it confuses you. You gotta think in English before speaking it. So it's complicated. Yeah, I can understand that.
Yeah, so no, you learned it at a young age, and that's the time to do it. You know, when you're older, trying to learn a new language, you know, even in my case where I really want to, it's not like I'm resisting. It's just takes a long time for certain concepts to stick.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah. Definitely. Yeah. Okay, so you're starting an acoustic tour?
Yes. A little over a week on the first show is on the 24th of this month.
Wow. So is this your first tour since the pandemic, or have you already been playing shows?
No, I've done a couple of little bits here and there, and I was lucky enough to, I was actually recently in the States to do a series of house concerts, which I really enjoyed. Mm-hmm. But yeah, this will be the first kind of concentrated tour, in fact. So it's a UK tour, and I was in the UK. It was March 2020, and I'd been there. I'd been in London for 3 days doing press for the upcoming tour, which was to support the album that I did with Dan Reed called Hurricane Riders.
And oh yeah,
we were touring together as an acoustic duet. And so the day of the first show, it was March 19th, I'm almost certain. He called me and said, dude, they're canceling flights. You know, we can't do this. We got to get out of here if we're going to get home. So that was it. You know, I'd been over there and ready to go. And I got the late flight out that night from England back to Spain. And sure enough, within the next day or two, Spain stopped letting any flights from England come in. So I just made it home.
Oh, it's just in time. Yeah, yeah, it's crazy. Yeah, it all went down so fast that, yeah, people were just stranded. Yeah.
It hit everywhere, too.
We were actually locked in our homes. It took a few weeks before they put it in, but we were actually locked in our homes for 47 days. No one was allowed out on the streets. You could only go out to either buy food or to go to the doctor. There were no other reasons allowed. They were not kidding. So it was a strange time.
Yeah, at first they said like it's only going to be 2 weeks, but when the 2 weeks were done, they said, well, it's going to be another 2 weeks. And so they kept updating the deadline for the lockdown.
That means we couldn't go to the record stores, man. That would be horrible.
No. Don't say that.
The albums for 47 days.
Never say that. So how was it playing with Dan? I'm a huge fan of his music. He's a great musician.
Yeah. Well, he and I got together, I want to say 2014. We did our first kind of little run together in a project that I called Snake Oil and Harmony. And he's a very good acoustic player. He's an excellent storyteller and, of course, a great singer. So we decided that rather than do a setup where one guy plays and the other guy sits there and listens, you know, we just both put our egos aside and said, look, you want to jump in on something, you know, songs that you know, or we can do some stuff together. Just go for it, you know, improvise. And so the whole show kind of became like that. And the same with the stories. We kind of ended up creating a very, very cool atmosphere between the two of us. So, yeah, I had a great time with him. And, you know, this is actually going to be a little weird doing this tour on my own.
Are you guys going to do any studio work or anything?
Well, we did. That was the album we were promoting. It's called Hurricane Riders. And, you know, we never got to play it live. So I'm gonna go out and do it on my own because Dan is now very deeply involved in a film project. So, you know, we had this tour postponed twice now. And he just, you know, as many of us did, he got himself deep into other stuff and got involved in a shooting schedule that he can't break now. So rather than just not tour at all, I thought I'd go out on my own and just see if I remember how it's done.
I'm sure it'll come back to you real quick.
Yeah.
Hopefully.
So you're playing the stuff from that album and also stuff from your career, or what's the idea?
Yeah. In fact, what I did, just because I like a challenge, is I kind of put it out there on Facebook and some of the Instagram, some of the others, and said, look, if you are definitely coming to one of my shows, if you've already bought a ticket, tell me what show you're coming to and name one song that you'd like to hear me play that night. Hmm. So basically the fans are choosing my set lists. And, you know, you would think, well, you know, they're all going to pick Standing Alone and they're all going to pick Forever Young and they're all going to pick Wakes. Now I've got to be ready to play about 90 different songs on this tour.
Can I pick one? I want to pick one. I would love to. Oh, well, yeah. Well, I got to, yeah. airfare may be a little steep right now, but I mean, I would love to hear an acoustic version of End of Summer Days.
Oh, yeah, we're definitely doing that one.
Yeah, that's an amazing song. One of my favorites, in fact. Yeah.
Yeah, he already mentioned one of my favorites, so. I love Wings, so I always have since that album came out. I love that song.
Songs like that, you know, Standing Alone, Forever Young, those are going to be in the set regardless. But I was impressed at how people, you know, chose, you know, some different deep cuts and things like that, and it just makes every single night completely different, which is great for me. You know, I love it. It just means I got to carry a book with lyrics in it because I can't remember all of them.
Well, yeah, I mean,
I can only imagine.
I mean, when you got so much, when you've done so much stuff, I mean, it must be hard. I mean, I read that Motley Crue has like this little screen on stage when they play, and they only play the biggest hits they've been playing for 40 plus years. So at this point, you think they already know them by heart. But
a lot of artists do that, and I used to put it down, but I got to also tell you that as you get older,
could all use a little help sometimes.
Yeah, exactly.
But the important thing is you're out there, you're doing it, and you're doing it with no tricks or no gimmicks. You're out there just playing the music the way it is. That's the important thing. It's what's reaching the fan base, and people are there to see it live, and that's what you're giving them. And that's the important thing right here. That's rock and roll.
Yeah, well, you know, I did that all through the pandemic as well. I did initially, I think I did one show a week for a while. Then it was one a month, just from home, you know, because of course nobody was touring, there was no live music and venues were going down and all that. And to be honest with you, I just really needed an outlet. And so I don't know how many, we did 20 something shows over the period of the 2 years. And again, I didn't want to play the same songs every week. So I was always chopping and changing and coming up with new ideas, playing a few covers here or there. And so it's developed myself as a performer, as a guitar player. And, you know, I've kind of realized, like you said, yeah, I can do this. No tricks. You know, it's just me and a guitar. And, you know, no looper pedals, no bells and whistles. Works for some people, but I tend to try and keep things simple.
Yeah. And the stripped down version of things is always a nice change of pace as well. It's nice.
Plus, a lot of the songs, particularly some of the most famous ones, that's how they were written.
Yeah, right. Just me, yeah.
You know, Wings was written on an acoustic guitar. So was Standing Alone. You know, so was Seasons. So was Walk on Fire. You know, it was all written with me just noodling around on an acoustic guitar because that's really my instrument. I'm not very good electric guitar player. Acoustic, yeah, that's what I do all my writing on.
Awesome. So, on that subject, let's go a little bit to the past. It's a few years, actually. I have my Waysted on vinyl, like Save Your Prayers. This is an Argentinian pressing with the title translated. It says titles are in Spanish. Yeah, it's a little rough translation, but all the songs are in Spanish as well. and there's a little, so for the ones watching on YouTube, here's a really young version of Danny.
Yeah, young and spandex version.
Yeah, you actually used hairspray, a lot of hairspray back then, right? Yeah. So, was that tell us how you got started? Like, what got you into playing music and eventually joining Waysted and all that stuff?
Well, you know, I got started playing music not really by my own design, but because, well, I got involved with music in the first place because I went to a school where there were teachers who were very, very dedicated to the arts. And so here comes this little kid with this incredibly high, squeaky voice and just a ridiculous amount of energy. Just kind of picture David Lee Roth at like 7 years old. What are you going to do with this kid? You know, he won't shut up and he's got this high voice. And somebody went, let's stick him into chorus. Let's see if, you know, we can calm him down and get him some constructive vocal work. And I suddenly realized, and oh, I can sing. I didn't know that. You know, I used to sing all the time, but I didn't know that it was a skill, you know. So it just kind of always went that way. And as you become a teenager, and I didn't pick up the guitar at a young age like a lot of my friends did. I was a little bit of a late bloomer. And I just got dragged into people's bands because they were, you know, a singer's kind of like a necessary evil for a lot of bands. And they just go, well, who, none of us can sing. Oh, yeah, get Danny. He can sing. I'm like, oh, really? I can? All right. You know, so you just kind of get going that way. And, you know, with your first bands in school and, you know, playing Rolling Stones songs and, you know, having a great time and discovering pot and girls and all the things that happen when you're in your mid-teens. And it just kind of went from there. You know, I just kind of bounced from one person to another saying, hey, you can sing. Come sing in my band. It's like, all right, I'll come and do that then. There wasn't a big plan. And so that put me into eventually a group called Allied Forces when I was about 19, 20. And the New York, New Jersey club circuit was absolutely enormous. There were bands on that club circuit that were making thousands of dollars a night, you know, playing covers, just covers.
Right.
You know, one of the more famous ones is Twisted Sister. I mean, that's how they started out, as, you know, they're one of the best cover bands on the circuit. But there were all kinds like Split Sydney and White Tiger, and gosh, there were so many, and there's some that are still out there. And so I got involved in that. It was a nice way to sort of make a living, but more about, you know, meeting girls and having fun and all that sort of thing. And eventually Paul Chapman from UFO heard about me. He was living in Florida and had a band down there, and he sent somebody around to sort of scope me out, and somebody approached me and said, hey, you know, Paul Chapman from UFO is interested in you. Here's a phone number, call him. And now I'm a massive UFO fan, and I took the phone number, looked at it, and was like, yeah, Paul Chapman, right. Threw it out. You know, I was like, sure it is. Because remember, kids, this is all pre-internet. You couldn't check up on any of this stuff. And right. It was like the person came back like a month later and said, hey, you know, didn't you call Paul Chapman? I was like, are you serious? Really, Paul Chapman? I'm like, yeah. All right, give me the number. And sure enough. So the short of it is I ended up flying down to Florida and spending a couple weeks with him and his band. And we did a demo, and he was going back to the UK to take it to Chrysalis Records, because that was UFO's label. And he's like, yeah, I'm going to take this. We're going to have a record deal. You know, in a couple of months, I'll be calling you. You'll all be coming over to the UK. Fantastic. What an amazing setup. And then he went to England, and we never heard from him again.
Oh, no.
And the story of that was that he runs into Pete Way in a pub. They get drunk, and Pete says, never mind that. Join my band, Waysted. We need a guitar player. And Paul went, oh, okay. And that was that. He was gone. So the next thing is that things, you know, and I was a big fan of that band, too. They'd done like 3 albums. With a singer named Finn Muir, who's an awesome singer from Scotland. And but they ended up having a falling out. And so rather than do the old cattle call, Chapman just said, hey, look, you know, I work with this guy in America. He's really good. And, you know, he's a UFO fan, so he knows the stuff. I said, let's just get him. And so the next thing I know, you know, the phone rings and it's Paul, and am I ready? So it was an audition, and the audition was, I was going to fly over to England and play. We were going to learn like half UFO songs, half Waysted songs. And we were going to rehearse for 2 or 3 days. And then we were going to do a festival in a stadium in Israel. I said, if that works out, then you'll be in the band. So that was my audition.
Wow. And how many people were at that audition?
I think it was about 15,000 on that day.
Oh, wow.
15,000 judges. That's pretty awesome.
Yeah.
Well, here's the thing. So it was a festival. So it was bands of all kinds. It was a really weird lineup. The headliners were Marillion because Kaylee was out at the time. That was their massive first hit.
Yeah.
But it was like the Climax Blues Band, Al Di Meola. Man, it was just like, it was jazz.
All over the place.
You were the only hard rock band on the bill. and so, you know, we did the show, had a massive party afterwards, got absolutely hammered, got into all kinds of trouble, almost got arrested by the Mossad. And then the next morning, I wake up very late with a hangover, and basically all the two main newspapers in Tel Aviv all have my picture on the cover. So it was kind of like, well, I guess you're in.
Nice, awesome. So you guys got some support from Steve Harris, like from Iron Maiden. I remember seeing a lot of pictures with the waist, where he wears a Waysted t-shirt.
Harry, you know, Steve Harris started playing bass because of Pete Way. Pete was his hero, and then they became good friends. Same with Nikki Sixx, by the way. There's a couple of guys that just readily admit that, you know, Pete Way made bass cool for them.
Right.
So Pete maintained a friendship with a lot of really wonderful people. And yeah, so Steve was a massive supporter of Pete's. And, you know, we did some shows with them both in Eastern Europe. And then we got part of the American and Canadian leg of the Somewhere in Time tour. So, we were up in your neck of the woods, Dave. We played Cleveland. We played Columbus.
Nice.
I think there might have been another Ohio date. I can't remember. But, yeah, we were on that tour with them. That was absolutely one of the best things I've ever been able to do.
Yeah, that's one of those tours, man. They don't you don't see a whole lot from that tour for Iron Maiden. Hardly anything out there.
Yeah, well, it was, you know, pre-phone day, so, you know, you weren't able to lug your shoulder holster video camera into most venues.
I don't even think the band themselves have a lot of footage from that time. And that Somewhere Inside, that's my favorite Maiden album too. So
yeah, but it's one of my favorites as well. For sure.
Yeah, I love it.
Yeah,
go ahead. We're talking all over each other.
Yeah. No, you go ahead, Dave. What are you gonna say?
No, I was just gonna say that would have been awesome had it not been. That would have been what, 86, 87, right around there.
Yeah, that's right.
I was still a little too young to be going to those shows at that time. I was a couple years after that, but that would have been a great show to see you guys, and then Maiden on that tour would have been awesome.
Yeah, it was a good double bill, and like we said, they were so supportive of us, you know, that there was no cutback on sound or lights or anything. It's like whatever we needed to make the show work. Because let's face it, when you're opening for Iron Maiden, the crowd ain't there to see you, and you know, you do get those days that are difficult where the audience is like, yeah, okay, whatever, fuck you, get off. We want Iron Maiden. You know, that can be difficult, but they supported us through that. So it was a remarkable experience.
Yeah, that's very awesome. It's good when you get that kind of support that you kind of need when you're going through that. I can only imagine, you know, how that feels.
Yeah, well, not every band treats their opening acts well. So, you know, we were blessed to have them.
Yeah, so and the Save Your Prayers album is a great album. I love the song. Well, yeah, I mean, it's the hit song, right? Heaven Tonight. It's a great song. I always like that. So the drummer on that album is Johnny D, right? Who then went on to play with Brittany Fox.
Yeah, and is now joining me in TYKETTO. So you live long enough, wow, and life moves in circles.
Right, that's awesome. Yeah,
that nice. Is awesome.
Yeah, so what happened? The things kind of fizzled out after the album, or what happened? What prompted you to work?
Well, unfortunately, you know, Pete and Paul both lived up to the name Waysted very well. And it got us, got us in a lot of trouble. And people, you know, once that album was put out by Capitol Records EMI, so that was like a really big chance for Pete in particular, because he'd been with, you know, smaller indie labels. And the reason they got me was because the bigger labels wanted them to try and sound a bit more mainstream. You know, I mean, you know, Journey was the biggest band in the world at the time, so everybody was trying to have more melodic singers. And so Pete kind of went along with that, even though it really wasn't what he was into. But it just, it self-destructed, unfortunately. I always tell people, so with that band, I learned a lot of things that you're supposed to do and a lot of things that you're not supposed to do. I got to watch it all.
Right. Yeah. Well, it definitely was like, yeah, like a learning experience, right? For you, you were just getting started and you learned. Oh, absolutely.
It was first everything, first album, first video, first tour, all of it.
Yeah. So, yeah. And what got you? When did you decide to form your own band after that?
Well, when I got, you know, after Waysted kind of fizzled out, I had a lot of good connections and I just expected, you know, my phone to start ringing and I'd be back out on the road soon with somebody else. And it didn't happen. The phone just didn't ring that much. There were a couple of little things that popped up, but nothing that really bore any fruit. And I suddenly realized if I was going to get back out there, I was going to have to, you know, basically captain my own team. And so I had met Michael Arvini purely by chance doing a demo for him. He was actually doing a drum audition for Whitesnake. So a bunch of us in the neighborhood kind of got together and contributed to the demo that he did. And that was about 86, I think. So come 89, I was like, I wonder if I still got that drummer's number. He was really good, you know. And I knew he, unfortunately for him, you know, missed getting the gig because I, you know, the next album came out and he wasn't on it. So I called him and we got together and just really hit it off and started looking for the right people to fill the band out.
Awesome. So I always wanted to know the story behind the name, if it means anything or it's a word.
I can't believe there's anybody that doesn't know that story.
Well, here, you got a virgin one here.
Okay. So unfortunately, it's not a very interesting story. We just, you know, bands go through a period where, you know, you start getting bleary and you start naming yourself after the furniture in the room. It's like, what? Or, you know, if you don't want to call yourself by your last name or whatever. Right. And Brooke had been out working in Brooklyn and he came back. He says, guys, he said, I saw this graffiti on a wall. I said, I don't know what it is, but it's really kind of cool. He said, it says TYKETTO. What is that? I don't know. You know, we started asking people, you know, is it something in another language? Was it a gang tag? We didn't know, but we liked the sound of it. And we just kind of went, you know what? That'll do. We'd chosen a couple, we'd gone by a couple of other names before that, and they were really awful. So kind of like nice to have, but the odd postscript about that is that after the first album came out, somebody at Geffen said, hey, you know, the story was part of our bio. And they said, hey, you know, you got your name from a graffiti on the wall. Why don't you guys see if you can find that wall again and take some pictures by it?
Right.
So we thought, oh, that's a great idea. So we drove around. Brooke tried to remember the neighborhood and all that. And we found it. And we realized that Brooke needed glasses because it said TYKETTO.
No.
That's hilarious.
So, yeah, I'm glad you didn't come back with that because I don't think that would have flown.
I guess, but no, definitely.
So did you guys go and find a new wall and do the photo shoot right? The can of spray paint?
I think we did. We just spray painted it ourselves.
Yeah. I gotta jump in here when it comes to that first album. So at that time, 91, I was really into the scene hardcore. I mean, I had, you know, had everything going. We had a band out here in Cleveland, or Valley City, like a suburb of Cleveland. And I remember that album coming out, and at the time I was buying cassettes, and the video for Forever Young came, was like on Headbangers Ball or something. It was, and I was blown away, man. I was like, I 100% just into it. And it's one of those albums that I listen to a lot. And it, even today, it still sounds fresh and new. And what blows my mind is how quickly the music scene had changed at that point. And I feel like you guys really missed out on what could have been. Because, I mean, that album's like, to me, it's like a perfect album. It's so...
Thank you. I think, you know, it's a very streamlined album. It was made, you know, the intention behind all the songs was very similar. You know, if you think about what that time period, you know, Bon Jovi ruled the planet at that time. Yeah. And so the idea was, you want to write songs that you could see like 10,000 people raise their hands up or sing along with or whatever. Try to create, you know, arena rock anthems. And so, you know, we really set out to sort of explore how to do that. And so, yeah, as the first album is compared to the second album, you know, there's a second album, Strength in Numbers, is more like us branching out and trying new stuff and different ideas. But yeah, Don't Come Easy was very, very streamlined. We lived together, we wrote together, we worked together. So we had this kind of band camp thing going before anybody, you know, even knew what that was.
Right.
And it was a very concentrated period of time. So, it, you know, it has, I think all the songs are cohesive that way. They sound like they were written in the same period, which almost all of them were.
Yeah, it's almost, it's just not a concept album, but it has that feel. Like, you feel like you're living these stories, like, or a story. And to me, I don't know. I was just really drawn to that record.
Well, I appreciate that. And we've been so, you know, how lucky am I? It's 30 some odd years later, and here we are sitting talking about it. And people still want to hear it. You know, you're right. It was, a lot of things fell into place. Luckily, the stars aligned for us as far as, you know, the sound of the album, the people that were involved in making it. So the only thing that went against us was time. And there's, you know, you can armchair quarterback it all you want, but I mean, the album sat in the can for 6 months. And DGC was like, nah, we don't release it now because this is out and it'll be competing with that and it'll be competing with this. After a while, our managers was like, Jesus, put the frickin' album out already, you know?
Right. Yeah.
So, you know, they did, and we kind of made our mark, and you know, things changed quickly. So, it's a lot of people said if the album had come out in 1989, you know, we might be Whitesnake now, but who the hell knows?
I mean, you don't know. I mean, but things would have been different too. It would have been a completely different album in 89. I mean, you go through all that. And you guys worked, Richie Zito was the producer on that, right?
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah, and he worked with White Lion on their 1991 album, Main Attraction, which I feel is, you know, is a great album too. And you guys also, you guys did the tour with White Lion, didn't you?
They grabbed Richie because they heard our album. If you look at Main Attraction, you may notice there's a song on there called Love Don't Come Easy. Mike Tramp was really paying attention to TYKETTO, trust me. We got Richie, he had just finished with Heart and Cheap Trick. I mean, and big albums, you know. Cheap Trick had, he did the one that The Flame was on. It was, he'd work with Eddie Money.
Great producer.
We were under a lot of pressure to perform because, you know, he was a top dollar guy.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So did you guys choose him, or was it assigned by the label?
No, you know, a lot of names were kicked around. We met with a few different people. there were some people that the record label were pushing, and we really fought them on it because their stuff sounded a little too processed. If you remember that time period, it was, you know, I felt anyway, bands, you know, this is when bands started putting backing tapes on stage live so that they could cop all the vocals that they'd done for their album, you know, because the album had like 15 tracks of vocals. And we didn't really want to go there. So we wanted to find somebody that had a little bit of an idea of how an older school rock album should sound as well. And, you know, Richie having that Eddie Money pedigree, that was right in there. So, yeah, in the end, it was a good compromise between us and the record label picking Richie.
Yeah, it's almost like the album almost sounds like it was one of those albums that was like recorded live in the studio, you know, where it just had that feel. At least for me, that's how I felt. And
yeah, I mean, it's that big arena rock sound, right? Like that's so typical from the early 90s as well, right? That big melodic metal arena rock with the big guitars and all that. I don't know, the sound stage sounds so large. And
we recorded that. All the basic tracks were recorded in A&M Studios in the big room. And if you want to see what that looks like, just go look at Michael Jackson's We Are the World. When they did that with all those singers, and that's the A room.
Yeah.
So it's expensive. Yeah. And therefore, you know, the drum sounds you can get in there are pretty ridiculous because you have an enormous room to work with.
Right.
And it probably at the time might have been one of the most expensive studios in the world. And it's just an amazing place.
Yeah, did Geffen give you support for the album? Because they got a reputation of just screwing over the bands that they signed. So.
No. I mean, you know, there was on some of it, they worked very, very hard. They just, you know, we were with DGC, so was Nirvana, right? So they were our label mates. And I can tell you from just talking to people in the offices and things like that, they got Nirvana because Nirvana was selling lots of copies of their own self-made EP called Bleach. Mm-hmm. And they were doing it like out of the backs of their cars and doing really well. And record companies hate when somebody else is doing well. So they picked up on them, threw some money at them, but they thought, all right, well, you know, they sold 30,000 copies of their self-made one. So if we can boost that up to 100,000, we're happy, you know, and then they released the first Nirvana album. They had no idea that album was going to do what it did. No clue.
Yeah. I don't think anybody did. going back to recording in that A room and how you mentioned the drums. I mean, even in Forever Young, the drums really stand out in that song to me. I think Michael's drumming was just, I don't know. And that you said that, I mean, definitely a big sound.
Yeah, no, Michael's a classy head. That's how I describe his drumming. Classy beast drumming.
Yeah, no, that's so. Before you guys record all of that, so did you ever consider? So you're based out of New York, but did you ever consider like going to Los Angeles or maybe moving out west, like so many bands did back in the day?
Yeah, exactly. There comes a point in every band's career, or came a point anyway, where you kind of you're offered that choice. If you're in LA, particularly back then, 80s and 90s, that means you're right in the middle of it. That means, you know, everyone you know is going to be in the music business. And I have to be very honest with you. I could never stomach LA for more than a couple of weeks. You know, there are no waiters in LA, just guys holding food with scripts. You know, it's just, there are no plumbers in LA. They're all, you know, actors just waiting to be discovered. It kind of gets on you after a while. And I didn't have the stomach for it. Looking back, I don't know if it was a good idea or not. I mean, because you get guys like my dear friend Jeff Scott Soto. He knows everybody because he made that choice. And he said, no, LA is where I got to be. And therefore, you know, he moves and shakes amongst hundreds of bands. He's in that circle whereas, you know, I never was.
Mm-hmm. Right. Yeah. Well, yeah, I mean, it was definitely not for everybody. And there was also a big scene in New York. It's not like there was nobody playing there as well. I mean, Skid Row, you got Spread Eagle, you got lots of big bands playing there.
Well, yeah. I mean, you know, Bon Jovi was out of New Jersey.
Bon Jovi, yeah.
Springer was starting in New York. You know, there was a lot of us, and we all know each other. It's kind of like graduating class, you know?
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah, a lot of my favorites came from the New Jersey, New York area. So, and I don't know if it's just maybe just something in the water there. I don't know. The sound completely different from the LA sound and to me. You know, when it comes down to the guitar playing, it seemed like there was a whole different style to the guitar playing than there was in some of those LA bands.
When you look at the influence, I mean, you take a band like Skid Row, mm-hmm. You know, what are they influenced by? Well, what was happening growing up in New York? It was the Ramones, you know, I mean, mm-hmm. I remember seeing those guys just hanging out down in the Village one time before they were huge. And just going, damn, that's a scruffy bunchy looking dude. Yeah. But that kind of music in, you know, Skid Row was infused from that kind of New York punk, you know, that was so big in Max's and CB's and all those places, which were hot. I mean, mm-hmm. even people that didn't play that music, you know, Aerosmith cut their bones there. So, you know, Bowie was always there. You know, it was definitely a big scene coming up in the 70s and 80s in New York City.
Yeah, I remember going to New York in 2001. Actually, it was, strangely enough, it was a week prior to 9/11. And we went there for a video shoot at CBGB's. There was a band that I was really into at the time called Bouncing Souls. We're like a poppy punk band. They're still around today. And we went for their video shoot, and we came from Cleveland. Me and my ex-wife came to Cleveland from Cleveland to New York, and their bass player gave us a tour. They were just shocked that people from Cleveland came, and they gave us a tour of CBGB's. Got to meet Hilly and everything. That was pretty cool. That was definitely awesome to walk in there and just, you know, there was that real thin aisle. I'm sure you've been in there. Thin aisle. Where the bar was off to the right, and then everything. I was just like in awe just walking in there.
It's funny, isn't it? Because it's so famous. And let's be honest, it was a shithole.
Oh, God, it was terrible, dude. I didn't even want to go to the bathroom because I was afraid I'd come out of there with hepatitis.
Absolutely. Like,
but it was cool.
You know, your feet stuck to the floor, the whole thing. No, nobody ever cleaned anything. They just threw black paint all over it, you know.
They just repainted,
feet sticking to the, that's like the certifier, right? Like the that you're in a, that the, when your feet stick to the floor, you know, you're at a rock and roll place.
I mean,
you know, it was certainly much nicer place, but you know, Cleveland had the Agora. That was like the place that everybody went to, you know. Certain town, Brooklyn had L'Amour, which one time was probably the most famous club, rock club on the planet. You know, there was a lot of good stuff going on back then.
Yeah, I miss the days of the good old rock clubs, man, where you would go into a show and it was just the feeling of everything, the atmosphere and the people and everything. It was just, it's awesome. And, you know, it's cool to see that there's a little bit of a revival here with the genre of music that obviously we all love. It's awesome to see, like, I love to see like younger people getting into it. And that's cool. Like my kids, even though both my kids aren't all into it 100%, they still have their favorites. My oldest is actually, he loves TYKETTO. He's a big TYKETTO fan. And, I told him we were having you on today, and he's like, "Oh, no way." He's living in Columbus for work, and he's like, "Man, Dad, I wish I could be there for that." And I was like, "Well."
You'll have to watch it. You'll have to watch
it. Yeah, that's right. Well, you have to subscribe and watch, kid.
Like and subscribe and share.
Yeah. I don't think he really supports it too much. He's kind of like, he goes, Dad, you're having who on? I don't know that guy. But when I told him you were coming to be on, he got pretty pumped about that. He's like,
well, I mean, if it's you're his dad, you're never going to be cool to him. So
No, I'm not cool anymore. They don't even come around anymore. My kids are grown up. I don't see him. But my oldest did say he wants to start a band, so let's see where that goes. He wants to sing, so we'll see. No, go ahead. I was going on a tangent, you know.
Now I was just gonna say, so a lot of bands have a hard time, when they had to record their second album. It's a famous, so many bands have.
Sophomore curse.
The sophomore, exactly. But I don't think you guys suffer from that. I mean, the second Strength in Numbers is just the same level as the first one, at least for me, in terms of songwriting, the instrumental. I mean, it's just so good as well. And it's a shame that it didn't get the support that the first one did. I mean, of course, you are not on Geffen anymore at that point, but I think it's a great album as well.
We recorded that album. Geffen spent a lot of money on that. That album got so far as, now this is something you probably won't remember, but they used to do a thing where before an album came out, they would send out blank cassettes to radio stations. And, you know, it was just like, here's a song from the album that isn't out yet, just for you, you know? And they had done that for us. You know, they actually sent out "Coming Soon," the new TYKETTO record. They actually sent that to radio stations, and then they dropped us. So I mean, they'd spent $100,000 or more getting everything ready, making the album, getting the promo ready, and then somebody in the accounting office just went, "Nah," and that was it. It was over.
Wow.
You know. So,
wow. Yeah.
The only thing that was amazing about that you don't hear too often, and I put this down to John Kolodner, was, you know, they paid for those master tapes, and they said, take the master tapes. If you can find someone to release this, you know, go with God. We're happy to have it. So we were at least able to take this wonderful recording that we'd done and eventually got it released on Music for Nations in Europe.
Yeah,
that's good. It got out to the public, and we were able to hear it.
Which was another 2 years to do it. That was the problem.
Yeah, but you know, your true fans weren't going to go away. You know, so and here we are.
You know, we've got such a devoted fan base in England and in Europe that we always had a place to play. You know, because unfortunately, America is kind of renowned for having a short attention span when it comes to music. So. You know, if you're out, you're out, which seems odd in a country of, you know, 350 million people. You would think that, you know, regardless of whether a music style is popular at the time, you could find plenty of places to play. But it's really not true. you know, we don't get to play the States as often as I wish we could. You know, that stuff, you get these special events like the Monsters of Rock Cruise, you know, specifically for what we do. And that's all nice, but you can't tour the States. It's too big a country.
Yeah, you get that a lot from other bands too. Like one example is Ugly Kid Joe. They're one of those bands that they never come over on this side. And then Wasp was the same way. This is Wasp's first time back here in like over a decade, I believe. So
right,
I mean.
Well, that's why a lot of bands like to play South America, actually, because we don't get that many hard rock bands to come here every year, right? It's not like we don't have that much of an offer. So whenever someone comes here, it's like a big event, right? Everyone wants to go, and that's why a lot of bands want to play here. I mean, and not only hard rock bands. I mean. Coldplay just played like 10 consecutive 80,000 seater stadiums. They played 10 consecutive shows. all sold out. It's incredible. Yeah. I mean, just the amount of money is stratospheric, but yeah. It's crazy. And on a smaller level, you get that with hard rock shows as well. Eric Martin from Mr. Big played a show, like I think last Saturday or something like that. And yeah, he sold out that show, and it was only him. He wasn't playing with Mr. Big. So, and maybe if you play that in the States, maybe you don't get to sell out that, right?
Yeah, that show's not going to sell out. Yeah.
Yeah.
I can vouch for that.
I would love to get to South America. You know, we've only ever played Rio de Janeiro, and you know, I'd like to get down there and meet more rock fans from there, because I do run into people. Again, with the Monster Rock Cruise, you know, there are people from Brazil and Peru and Venezuela. It's like, so there's a lot of rockers out there.
Yeah, well, you guys are rocking Rio, even though there's not a lot of rock lately on that.
I love those festivals over in other countries, man, where, you know, I remember being, you know, as a kid, getting the Moscow Music Peace Festival on pay-per-view. That was awesome to see. And then you have all the, like, what's the other one?
Rockin' what?
I can't think of what it's called. It's still pretty big today. Rock AM? Is that it? Rock?
Rocklahoma?
No, not that one.
there are so many.
There's so many huge ones, yeah.
Yeah, that's a lot.
Yeah, there are a lot of smaller ones now that are doing quite well as well, which is fantastic. You know, where it's like 3,000 to 5,000 people kind of thing. But, you know, there's some really great ones like Stone Dead in the UK.
Mm-hmm. You got the Fyre Fest. I don't think they do that anymore, but for a while.
They might bring that one back. But yeah, we're doing one in France in May. So there's some stuff out there.
Did you ever play the Sweden Rock Festival?
Yeah, we did that in 2010.
Yeah, that's a big one as well, right?
Yeah, it's massive. That one's huge.
I just had a couple friends of mine from Australia, just they're in the UK right now, and they just played Hard Rock Hell. Right. That seemed pretty cool. Skid Row was on that, and Ugly Kid Joe were on that. Enough's Enough.
Yeah. So, we're doing that one. When are we doing that one? They just announced it. Oh, next November. So this time next year, we're on it.
Okay, yeah. So, yeah, cool. Yeah, that seemed like a pretty cool, you know, they seem to get a good response from that. So that's pretty cool.
It's got a lot of good, you know, it's the fans. The fans do really well with that show.
That's awesome. It is good that the support is out there for the rock scene. Unfortunately, like you said about the United States, I'll always support it in the United States. That's
for sure. That's the problem. It's like, you know, could TYKETTO play in the U.S.? Yeah, we could. We could play in New York, New Jersey. We could play in Dallas. We could play in Chicago. There's a lot of miles between those places, and you got to find some way, you know, to pay the bills. So it's just not possible.
Yeah, and that's sad. And I want to touch a little bit on Cleveland, because you were born here. You are a Clevelander, technically.
I was very briefly.
You carry the stain. Yeah.
Well, I still have family there. My mom's side of the family lived in Chardon and places like
that. Oh, okay. Yeah. Well, you know, I recently reached out to you about the Cleveland Rocks documentary that I'm doing. So I'm actually learning more about the Cleveland rock scene than I thought I knew. You know, at the time I was just a kid going to, like, and I don't know if you remember any of these clubs. I don't know if you remember Flash Gordon's or the Empire Concert Club or the Akron Agora, the Cleveland Agora, Shadows, all these clubs. I've been speaking with not only the bands, but the owners of some of these venues as well. And man, I would have loved to have you be a part of this. I mean, I know your time here was very, very brief.
Well, I mean, my contribution to it is that, you know, that's where my parents met. My dad was born in Cleveland. My mom moved there when she was very young. So going further back than what you're talking about, you know, I'm sure it's part of the documentary. I mean, the first rock radio station in America was Cleveland. Mm-hmm. And it was the Moondogs, the Moondog Hour, and it happened at midnight.
And with Alan Freed.
So my cool little story is that, you know, my dad used to listen to the Moondog Hour as long as his dad didn't hear it, because he'd freak out. The one of the first dates my mom and my dad went on was Bill Haley and the Comets.
Nice.
Oh, wow.
So yeah, that's pretty serious first start for rock and roll pedigree, because that was really, really one of the first rock and roll bands that existed.
Yeah, no doubt, man. That's awesome.
Was Shake, let me get your opinion here. Was Shake, Rattle and Roll the first sleaze metal song?
I don't know. Could be. I mean, you know, what's that?
No, I mean, the lyrics are just naughty, man.
Yeah, well, anything having to do with Jerry Lee Lewis is going to be, you know, early rock and roll, man.
It's going to be a bit edgy.
I've heard that song forever, right? But when they say what's the line, the famous I'm like a one-eyed cat peeping at a fish store or something like that. I mean, yeah, it's a great song.
It's hard to believe that my parents would give me a hard time about the bands I listen to.
They got away with pretending they didn't understand. That was the best part of it. It was a little more clever. You know, all that, by the way, all that stuff, all those clever innuendos, that comes from the blues. Mm-hmm, so, right. For instance, you may not have heard of a blues song called "You Got the Right Key, Baby, But the Wrong Keyhole." You know, you can get away with singing that and everybody knows what you're actually singing about, but you know,
you just made it
clever. It's one of the things I loved about Bon Scott was he always made it clever and funny. You know, other bands just basically start singing about their dicks and you're like, all right, I'm bored. But Bon Scott made it funny.
It's definitely that. I mean, when Spinal Tap came out, they had that song, "Sex Farm," I think it was. I mean, it's really on the nose because it was supposed to be on the nose. But I cry laughing at all the innuendos and all the ways they find to say the same thing. Yeah.
You know, it's funny you bring up Spinal Tap, Danny. I gotta ask, man, do you have a Spinal Tap moment you can share with us?
Oh, man. They're all Spinal Tap moments. That is the most accurate, documentary ever made about music, without question.
Dude, I love it.
Every single thing in there has happened to all of us at some point or another.
Did you lose a drummer? Did you lose a drummer for a gardening accident?
Did you get lost backstage in Cleveland?
Well, not in Cleveland, but 100 other places, sure.
Trapped in a giant pod?
No, I mean, one of my Spinal Tap moments that comes to mind is, we're hurtling down the highway. This is TYKETTO now. We're hurtling down the U.S. highway in a big old tour bus, and it's an overnight, and everybody hates our bus driver. He's a complete jerk off. And so at some point or another, one of the brakes on one of the back wheels locked and started burning. Oh, yeah. And there were people like driving next to the bus, honking the horn, going, "Hey, hey," trying to point, like, you know, "Your wheel's on fire." And he's going, you know, it's kind of like if you remember Planes, Trains, and Automobiles, The guy's going the wrong way. It's like, how does he know where we're going? You know, it was the same thing. The driver's going, shut up, fuck you, you know, and he's driving along. So anyway, we're awakened by the smoke alarm going off in the bus. I roll out of, you know, it's like 4 a.m. I roll out of the bus, like, what the hell's going on? And my sound man has got a screwdriver out. He's standing in a bus filled with smoke, and he's trying to dismantle the smoke alarm, going, I'll shut this fucking thing up. I'm like, dude, it's doing its job. We're on fire. You know? All he cared about was going back to sleep.
Oh, man, that's funny. Oh.
Yeah, that's rock and roll. I mean, bus and fire, that's metal.
That is metal. Yeah,
we were very lucky. It wasn't worse than it was.
Right.
Yeah, well, you're laughing about it now, but I'm sure at the time it was like, what the hell?
Yeah.
Man. Well, we're glad that you're still here to, you know, share that moment with us.
Yeah, sure. Well, I've had a few close calls with buses. I almost fell out of one once. That was not fun.
Oh, no.
Oh, was alcohol involved?
No, I'm not. It was they have such a long base, you know, floor base, that the back door, I was coming down the steps. It was a European bus, so it had a downstairs lounge. And I was coming down the steps, and the handrail goes right along the door at the bottom, and the door just flew open at like 90 miles an hour. And I was kind of hanging by the handrail for a minute and almost going out the door.
You're like James Bond.
Kind of, yeah, like one of those scenes on a train.
Wow. Man, you could probably write a book with these stories.
Yeah, my wife keeps telling me I should.
Yeah, I mean, definitely.
Well, I would read it, that's for sure.
Yeah, there's a few little moments that are worth retelling, but you know, I was never in the big leagues, so I don't have the big, you know, 50 groupies in a bathtub story.
You know, everybody, that's another thing that, like, you hear about bands that are successful, they found success, whatever. I look at it this way: you recorded albums. You've played with great musicians. You're great musicians yourselves. You had videos on MTV. You have fans that are still willing to hear your stories and hear your music 30 plus years later.
I mean, you got someone in Argentina who has your fucking CD,
In my eyes, you guys were just as successful as, say, Bon Jovi, Metallica, or any of those guys. So
yeah, I mean, you know what? You're absolutely right. I've redefined my definitions of success many, many years ago. The fact that I'm still standing, still playing, and still making a living out of music. You know, I mean, I'm not driving a Ferrari. That's fine. I'll deal. I'll live with that disappointment. I'm okay with that. but the fact that, you know, I get up, you know. My father is a painter and an artist, and he has made his living all his life as a painter, doing what he loves. And so I'm kind of doing the same thing, you know? And so, yeah, you're right. I've made a small mark, and I still get out to play, and people want to hear it. And thank goodness, or whatever higher power you want to believe in, I've still got my voice, so I can still do it. So yeah, there is a certain level of success in there.
Yeah, and I'm sure me and Santi aren't the only ones that still put on Waysted or TYKETTO and enjoy it.
It's still out there. There's still plenty out there.
Yeah, definitely. So you also put out a bunch of solo albums over the years, right? Was that your plan, like, to start, kick off a solo career and leave the TYKETTO stuff behind, or what was your headspace at the moment?
Going back to what I told you about how it all started, I've never really had a plan. Just kind of happened that way. So.
Right. Yeah, I mean, yeah. Whatever feels right at the moment, right?
Yeah, you know,
I gotta do this.
Songs, and there's a possibility. I don't make too many solo albums because it takes me a couple years to forget how much hard work it is. and it's like when I've forgotten, I think, oh, I think I'd like to do an album. That couldn't have been that hard. And then I remember, oh yeah, it is.
Now, when you approach a solo album, is it different? Like, do you look at it differently? Do you like consciously try to be different than what you've done in the past? Like, you don't want it to sound like TYKETTO, or do you like? How do you differentiate?
The writings.
Yeah, exactly. Where you want to go with a solo project?
Oh, I don't think it happens on purpose. But the thing is that, you know, as a writer, I'm writing all the time. Mm-hmm. So, it a lot of stuff gets written without any plan for where it's going to go. You know, I'll write something and go, well, it's definitely not a TYKETTO song, whatever that is. You know, it's sounds a bit country or whatever. Mm-hmm. So it just goes into the files. And then at some point or another, you got a lot of files and you sit there. I mean, my last solo album, Myths, Legends, and Lies, is mm-hmm. a compilation of a series of songs that I've written, the oldest of which is 40 years old. The oldest of which is the first song I ever wrote. Leading up to stuff that I wrote about a month before I recorded the album. So it's all over the shop. And I referred to these songs as my orphans because I could never find a home for them. And you know, then one day there were enough orphans to put all in one under one roof. So that's really how it kind of goes. And I like a lot of, you know, a musician explores music. So, you know, if I hear a sound that I like and I'm like, oh wow, that's a tuba and a violin and all, how can I incorporate that into what I do? You know, I don't know, maybe I can't, but you want to try, you know, because music just never stops being exciting. So, when it comes time to write a TYKETTO album, then yeah, I got to put on my TYKETTO hat and make sure that I'm writing in a certain vein, you know, and working with a certain structure, you know, but for my own stuff, I just go where it takes me.
Yeah, that's something I've always found interesting when an artist goes from a band to doing a solo thing. And a lot of them, one of the like more different ones that I've ever heard was Greg Graffman from Bad Religion. He put out like his solo records, and they're completely different than, you know, his punk stuff with Bad Religion. And I always hear like how Paul Stanley's solo album in 78 is the closest to Kiss, you know. And everybody else, you know, it's weird, man, when a solo album comes out. And I always like to look at a solo album, and I think I want those artists to do something that sounds a little different. Don Dokken, when he put out his first solo album, man, that sounds just like a Dokken record.
I mean, you can't, it's a no-win situation because it's like a 50-50. Your fan, I mean, I take this not from my own experience, but from what I've seen of other bands. You know, if Paul Stanley goes and makes a solo album, well, who's going to buy it? Kiss fans.
Right.
Kiss fans really probably don't want to hear Paul Stanley's bluegrass phase, you know?
Yeah, I mean, I've listened to his Soul Station stuff, and I think that stuff's cool, man. I like when artists like that.
Yeah, no, I love it too. But like I said, you're up against the wall with it, because if you do an album that's really different, a lot of your hardcore fans go, you know, are turned off by it. If you do an album that's, you know, again, if a Paul Stanley album sounds like Kiss, you got a lot of people going, well, that's all he's got. You know, he's just playing to his crowd. You can't win. People have always got something to say. In the end, you're making the music that moves you at the moment.
Yeah, and yeah, so that's also a lot of when a lot of bands changed the sound, like by the mid 90s, a lot of people just lost interest because
there were some bands that did that because they liked the new sounds that were happening. You know, I think Winger did that very well.
Yeah, definitely.
There were also some bands that did it because, oops, you know, we're not popular anymore. We got to put on plaid shirts and frown a lot, and we're going to be grunge now. And it's like, ugh, You know, when you're doing that, don't, you know, it's because that's, if you make, you make music because, you know, to anybody that's in a band out there, don't try and be popular, because that's a dead end street. There's so few that get that lucky. You've got to make the music that appeals to you. You know, if you're loving it, then, you know, people who are watching you are going to pick that up. And that's how your music goes.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, definitely. And yeah, if it definitely shows when the band is not playing something that they truly like, and they're only doing it for the, I don't want to say for the money, but maybe to stay relevant, right? You can definitely tell, right? So, for example, I'm a huge fan of the Bullet Boys, but the albums that they put out in the mid '90s, you can really tell they were not really into that stuff, right?
I think one of the biggest ones for me that kind of threw me off was Def Leppard's Slang album. I've grown to love that album now.
That's my favorite Def Leppard album.
it took me a little while to get into it because I was so like, why did they do this? But now when I look back, I listen to that album now and I'm like, man, this is a pretty good, this is a really good album.
It's a great record. And it shows that they're great musicians, you know?
Yeah.
And I liked it for that very reason, that it was just like, okay, we could keep doing what has comfortably sold millions of records for us, but we want to do this. I took it as they were doing something because it excited them.
And, yeah. Yep.
You know, that works.
And I really like it. I mean, it's not, I wouldn't go and say, oh, this is their grunge album, but it was definitely an album that I think it was more like I felt it was very like a spiritual album with some of the songs on there. But I felt like it took them into a completely different musical direction. But what was cool about it is they slowly kind of brought it back when they put out Euphoria. They kind of brought it back to that Def Leppard sound, but that album, right, that Slang album, really, man, it well, really.
I mean, that's the reason though. Slang unfortunately tanked. I mean,
yeah.
People just were like, what, Def Leppard? No, it's not. And they're like, come on, you know?
Well, I think the thing is that if you want to listen to Soundgarden, you're going to go and listen to Soundgarden. You don't want to hear Def Leppard doing Soundgarden, right?
Yeah, I think you're right. We've already got a Soundgarden, so why try and
sound exactly. Yeah. But, I mean, I don't mind that. I don't mind when a band evolves naturally. I felt like Skid Row is a good example of that, when they went from the first album to Slave to the Grind, even into Subhuman Race, they got heavier, they got a little darker.
Slave to the Grind was them saying, okay, we got our record deal, now here's what we're about. The first album was a conscious, you know, they were under Bon Jovi's wing. That album was a conscious effort to get into the big club. They got into the big club and said, okay, fuck you, this is what we really want to sound like. And Slave to the Grind came out. And that album blew us all out of our chairs when that came out.
Yeah, I mean, like, wow.
Where did this come from? You know. And then we had a band like Metallica, arguably put out, to some people, their best record that same year. But Metallica kind of mellowed out, where Skid Row got, you know, went a heavier direction. And it was just, for metal fans, man, it was like crazy. And then, you know, and then you guys came out not too long after that, right? You were kind of in the middle of all that.
Wasn't the Black Album and like Nevermind and Use Your Illusion like released between, like 2 weeks ahead, between each other, something like that?
Maybe so. 91.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think, yeah. Well, Slave to the Grind was the first one, because that was Slave to the Grind was the first metal hard rock album to debut at number one in 91.
Wow.
And then Lies, or not Lies, Use Your Illusion 1 and 2 came out shortly after that. Then they were 1 and 2. I don't know where Nevermind was in there, But Nevermind didn't really hit until 92. It was like closer to 92 when Nevermind took off, even though it had been out for for like a year.
Well, boys, I don't mean to be rude, but we're going to have to wrap this up. I got to go get some dinner.
It's getting late.
That's usually Stancy's move when he wants to stop talking to me.
No, that's not
true. Now the guests are using it, man.
So to wrap it up, we always finish the episodes with a little top three favorite albums. So what would you say are yours?
Gotta be three, huh?
Mm-hmm.
It can
be bands. It doesn't have to be albums, but...
Well, Led Zeppelin, Physical Graffiti, Rolling Stones, Exile on Main Street, King's X, Gretchen Goes to Nebraska.
Wow. That was the fastest that's ever been done.
Yeah. Awesome. Yeah, you're hungry. Awesome. Well, King's X, that's a great album. Yeah, it's so different as well, but... Great album nonetheless. All right, so Danny, thank you very much for being on the show. We love talking with you. I feel we could talk for hours, and you've been great. You're a friend of the show now, so whenever you want to come back and promote either a new album or a new tour or whatever, you're always, or just talk with us because you like us, that's all allowed. So
we haven't run out of stuff talk about. We'll do this again for sure.
All right. So,
Andy, it was awesome, man. Thank you. And
thank you.
I'll try to keep you up at speed on what's going on with the Cleveland Rocks documentary, so you can check it out.
Yeah, do that. And like I said, you never know. I mean, I'm doing a lot more of these house concerts, and I did a lot in America recently. So, if I can kind of find my way out to your area, it would be nice to do a show out in that area somewhere.
Yeah, it would be awesome.
If you ever feel like a South American vacation, beers are on me.
Okay.
<I'll do that. laughs> All right, man. Take care.
All right. Thanks, guys. You have a good night.
Thank you, Dan. You too. Enjoy your dinner, man.
Bye.
Thanks. Bye.